Do you know how the ship is chartered? Do you know how the whole chartering process looks like? Do you know what are orders and position? In this lecture, we'll be looking into these. Hey, what's up? My name is Akash from ShipScoop, bringing you the best platform to learn about the commercial shipping subjects. In the Chartering 101 series, we have seen the basics of chartering in lecture number 1. And right now, we are going to focus upon the chartering process. And if you're new here, consider subscribing it at any point of the video. Also, check out the notes and links in the description below. And guys, you can always head to my website and get the whole content downloaded. The whole package consists of comprehensive lecture notes, which we are studying right now, past ICS papers, past solved ICS papers, and my own lecture notes, which will help you to understand this subject very well. Hi guys, welcome to lecture 2 of Chartering 101 by ShipScoop. So today, we'll be studying into the chartering process, what are orders, position, rule of negotiation. We'll be looking into offers, counter offers, the content of a firm offer in a voyage charter body, followed by a time charter body, how the whole negotiation stage looks like, subjects, and finally, we'll be concluding our lecture 2 with the summary. So what is chartering process? The first behalf is fixture negotiation and finalization. The second part is charter party negotiation and finalization, post fixture operations. And finally, we have this financial settlement. It is divided into 4 parts. The first one is a fixture. What is a fixture? It means it is a contract between the ship owner and charterer. To conclude the contract, it's known as fixture negotiation. Prefixture is something which involves the finalization of the charter party terms, conditions, exemptions of contract, negotiation phase between the charterer and the ship owner. Then there is something called as post-fixture activity, the activity which happens after the vessel is fixed. Activity mainly concludes the fixture, as I said. Operation department is the one who actually executes the whole contract. We have voyage orders, which comes from charterers, and we need to make sure that it is being followed by the ship's captain. This is mainly done by the ship operators. They will even do something called as claims, which consists of PDAs and FDAs, which is pro forma disbursement accounts and final disbursement accounts. Activity, they make sure that, you know, they check all the activity which is happening, if the ship is entering, at what time it is entering, how it is entering, and the discharge port as well. They keep a very close watch. They even monitor the cargo operation, how long it is taking, and they deal with claims too, regarding demurrage and freight. So how the whole chartering process looks like is, it can be summarized in this whole picture. Now if you see, there are 3 main players. As you studied in lecture 1, there is charterer, there's a broker, and there is a ship owner. So broker is the one who is providing liquidity to the market. He's the one who is the middleman between these two. So the charterer is the one who floats an inquiry which goes to the broker. When he sees, the broker sees an opportunity, he connects that to the ship owner, in which he sends a firm offer. And that is how the negotiation starts between charter and the ship owner, where counter offer is offered. And if you see guys, the order is from the charterer, the position is from the ship owner, the voyage estimation is done by the ship owner's behalf, commission from charterer, brokerage from the broker. We'll be looking into all of these things in our upcoming lectures. What is a quote by charterers? So it consists of like this. So the first thing is, you need to know how much, what kind of cargo it is, what is the type, and what volume and storage factor it is. It gives us the quantity. Then we need to know what are the load, port, and discharging. What are the lay days, lay can, what is the loading window, loading and discharging rates to be known. This whole thing comes up with the cost. And then we have the freight indication and other information which is given by the charterers. So there's one example. Formosa Plastics, cargo is this, 60,000 metric ton, 5% more or less, charterer's option, coal in bulk. Load port is one safe port, safe berth, Hong Kong, China. Discharge port is one safe port, safe berth, Osaka, Japan. Lay can is this. Loading rate is given per weather working day, Sunday holiday included. And discharge rate is 10,000 metric ton per weather working day, Sunday holiday excluded even if used. Freight rate is this, FIOT. This term, if this term is included, that means the cargo handling costs are taken care by the charterer. Commission is given. And the position from the ship owner, it goes like, Formosa Falcon, vessel details, dead weight, summer dead weight, what all things are there, how long is the vessel, grain capacity, bale capacity. One peculiar thing to notice is, in loaded, it can, since the bunkers are again one of the most important factors in shipping, and it says that the ship owner claims the ship can, in loaded condition, it can reach 13 knots and it can, it at the cost of 18.5 metric ton burning IFO 380 CST and about 0.5 metric tons of diesel, marine diesel oil. So these are used for the auxiliary engines. In ballast conditions, when the vessel doesn't have any cargo in it, it can reach 13 knots at this consumption from IFO and 0.5 from MDO. There's this eco speeds given. When it is in port, what is the idle condition? This is the consumption. This is how it looks like. And when it's working in a port, it will consume 3.5 metric ton IFO, 1.2 metric ton diesel oil. Rules of the negotiation. Always to act within your authority. This term means that, guys, the ship brokers should make sure that they have explicit rights from their principals to negotiate. There have been in many instances or discrepancies that happened where ship brokers have tried to put up their vessels or put up their cargo and started negotiating even though they didn't have the explicit rights from the principals. So just make sure that you have a consent from them. Do not misinterpret. There have been instances again where different parties or different principals have interpreted the charter party clauses in a different way. So just make sure that both of them, that the ship owners and charterers, know what they are getting into. Do not offer the same ship cargo firm to more than one party at the same time. This means that when the ship owner, let's say he gets into, you know, when the subjects, like when the charter is trying to check the subjects, the ship is locked for a certain period of time where the ship owner can't negotiate his vessel with someone else. So it's an industry practice where you should not negotiate when the other party is checking for subjects. Just make sure that, do not open up a negotiation in that way. It will just spoil your reputation. An indication is not an offer. It is not binding on party making several indication. Maybe wait for cargoes at the one same time. The negotiation need to be conducted with care, taking into consideration the requirements of the charter. So the firm offer will usually have a time limit. That it is that potential charters, that business is available for the ship owners. This also helps with the freight rates from the owner's point of view. The word commencing the firm offer includes a time and limit. For example, firm offer can run as follows. From owners to charterers, brokers, time, date, and transmission of the message is given. Firm offer for applying Hong Kong latest time by this date and time. Greenwich mean time as follows for the details as appropriate. In a negotiation process, guys, so we do have certain phrases which we use. The first phrase is, we decline owners and charters offer and offer instead. This purely indicates that the offer is received, is rejected in its entirety, and new offer is put forward into consideration. This is what this statement means. If we use this statement in a negotiation, prefixes agreement. We accept owner's last offer except. This is where the counter offer is put up and certain points are listed, but rejects counter proposes on the point listed under rejection. We repeat our last. This is just a restatement of the previous communication. We repeat our last except. This is a fact that new offer signifying the rejection of the proposal received. Okay. And finally, we decline owner's offer without counter. This means that the charter finds the owner offer to be completely unacceptable. Things won't happen beyond this. So he wants to end the negotiation. This is where he uses this term. Before we get into the process, I would like you guys to understand just the basics of how the negotiation frame, the negotiation works as, the prefixes works as. The first thing is, guys, the charter floats an inquiry. You'll just try to understand how the prefixure looks like. It will make you understand much better once you have the basic concepts. Once you have the understanding of the basic concepts, we can start developing it, okay? So let's imagine the fact there are three players in the market. There's one charterer, and there's an independent ship broker, and there is a ship owner. Why I said the ship broker is just one, because there can be a ship broker who is representing the charterer, or there can be a ship broker who is representing the ship owner as well. But here, there is only one ship broker who is a middleman. Okay, the charterer comes in. He's floating an inquiry of 1 million metric ton of crude oil is available from Jebel Ali, UAE, and discharging in Sikka, India. He has given the lay days from 17 to 20th May. Now, he is giving his inquiry to the broker. Now, the broker, he looks for a Suezmax tanker because this is what a Suezmax can handle. And he sees which is near to the Jebel Ali region or a ship which can reach before 17th to 20th May in that region. Finally, he finds an owner, okay, whose vessel is just fits in that time frame. It's going to reach before this. So he contacts the owner and sends him as a private inquiry. Owner accepts the deal. He sees an employment opportunity. He says, okay, let's go for it. He registers and offers to the charterer. And this is where the chartering process begins. So he's offering his vessel. There's an offer from his side. So he says, his name of the vessel, Motor Tanker Style, opening load port, one safe port, safe berth at Jebel Ali. And discharge port is one safe port, safe berth, Sikka. Freight, he's asking for $4 million lump sum. So let's keep it easy for us. Let's just understand the basics. And he's asking for the demurrage is $30,000 per day. Validity, 10 minutes. We'll understand all these terms as we go ahead. I'm just making you understand how the whole prefixtures happens. The charter, the counter offer. He sees, oh my God, this is too much, charter says. He gives a counter to the ship owner via broker. Say that, let's say the freight is, he's asking for, he's giving the freight as $2.8 million lump sum and he's dropping the demurrage to $20,000 per day. Validity for 5 minutes. If the owner wants to continue, he has to reply before this time frame. Now the ship owner fails. Definitely he feels so less. Like, oh, come on. I asked for 3 million, 4 million. He's giving me 2.8. So let's give him a counter offer stating $3.8 million lump sum and demurrage is $28,000 per day. Validity, 5 minutes. Now the charter has to respond within this 5 minutes because this counter is only applicable for this time frame only. Charter comes in again. He feels it's too much. He increases from 2.8 to $3 million lump sum and demurrage from $22,000 per day. Validity again for 5 minutes. Again, ship owner feels that it's again less. So he gives a counter offer in this phase with $3.5 million lump sum and demurrages $26,000 per day. Validity 5 minutes. Charterer again. Finally, I mean, you know, so again, it's too much, you know. He says he's ready to give $3.2 million lump sum and demurrage of $24,000 per day. Validity, 5 minutes. And he goes to the, you know, broker as well, that boss, this is what it is now. Now, broker goes to the ship owner and he advises the charterers market guys. He advises them that just take the deal because it's a very sweet deal. And since it's a charter market, it's better, go for it. Ship owner sees an employment opportunity and he says, okay, fine, let's accept it. And he accepts the freight at $3.2 million lump sum and demurrage of $24,000 per day. This is what the whole, how the prefixtures looks like. And once this is done, guys, the ship is put on subject. We'll see how, go ahead. So this is how the whole prefixture activity happens, how the negotiation happens between the parties, how ship brokers play an important role. Okay, there are a lot of things to be learned, but as we go ahead, we'll try to build up on these topics. The charter party offer, I'm just giving a rough example here, is MV Style Panama built 2008. Cargo details is this, more or less owner's option, straight factor is given. Load port, discharge port is given, Jebel Ali. Freight rate, 25 metric ton, FIOS. Arrival and cancelling date is given as 15 to 30th September. Lay time is this. Working days, Sunday holiday exempted. Demurrage dispatch is given, 8,500 per day pro rata. Demurrage half, dispatch, lay time saved. Charter party will be used as Norgrain. Total commission is 1.5. Any other point subject to details. Now, this is information which is given by the ship owner to the charterer. Now, charterer comes with a counter offer, says accept freight rate which stays the same, but now instead of FIOS, he's asking for FIOT, free in and out stout, free in and out drip. That means the cargo handling cost is taken care by the charterer, but he wants to take care of the trimming thing. And arrival and cancelling dates, he's asking for, instead of 15 to 30th, he's asking for 1 to 15. That is how the negotiation looks like, guys. Okay. Let's see the content of a firm offer. Now, how does a firm offer looks like in a void charter? First thing is you need, as we said, place and time. You need to know the account. You need to know the ship's name. You need to know the particulars, name of the ship owner, cargo quantity, description, loading and discharging ports, lay days, cancellation dates, discharging, loading, discharging rates, demurrage dispatch rates, freight amount, conditions, clause governing, time counting, ice clause if you want, commission, which is more important, charter party form. Which charter party form would you like to inform? Would you like to use them? And finally, the subjects. We'll be looking into the content of the firm offer at a voyage charter. Owners would like to offer firm reply by today. This is the date and this is the time. The name of the vessel and its information. Account is the charterers, owners, Formosa Plastic. Cargo is bulk wheat, steward factor 15%, more or less owner's option. Loading and discharging port are given as one safe port Singapore and one safe port Vishakhapatnam. Always afloat except Napsa. Not always afloat but safely aground where customary. Lay can is given between 15 to 18 time. Loading and discharging rate, as we discussed, have been given as 6,000 metric ton, 3,000 per weather working day, Sunday holiday included. 3,000 metric ton per weather working day, Sunday holiday included. Demurrages, USD $10,000 per day, half dispatch DHT. Freight rate, USD 30 per metric ton, FIO. Freight rate payable, 95% less commission within 3 working days after the signing of releasing of bill of lading. Charterers agents, commission, this is most important, 2.5 ATCOM, which is by the charterers, and 1.25% is being given by the brokers. All other terms are conditioned to be discussed as per the charter party dated this. Okay, this is how the firm offer in a voyage charter looks like, because it is specifically for one voyage. Okay, let us put on subjects. Similarly, let's have a look in the content of the firm offer in a time charter. The reply by: account, name of the charter, ship's name, particulars, name of the ship owner, delivery, where do you want to get it delivered, lay days, cancelling dates, how long do you want to take it. So in time charter, we know that it's for a time, it's for a period where the fixed costs are taken care of by the ship owner and variable costs are taken care of by the charterer. Trading areas, what area should it trade in? What is it for intended trade? Cargo and trading exclusions, what are the higher rates? Where do you want to get it redelivered? Commission, charter party form, subjects again. Okay, this is how a rough firm offer with respect to time charter party, time charter should look like. We'll be looking into the content of the firm offer at the time charter. Owners would like to offer firm reply today, which is this date, 10 on Greece time now. This is the Greece time, okay? Name of the vessel is MV Athena. The information of the vessel, account, Falcon Navigation. The owners is Formosa Plastics. Delivery, where do they want to get this vessel delivered, is AFS PS Rotterdam, which is arrival first sea pilot and Rotterdam. Lay can is 15 to 20 this date with the time. Period, they're asking for 2 years of time charter within 30 days of more or less in charterer's option. Trading, worldwide trading, always within IWL, Institute Warranty Limits, good safe berth, good safe port, and AAA is always accessible, always afloat. Trading and cargo exclusions to be discussed and mutually as per the charter party details. Intended trade between Mediterranean and UKC ports, WOGs without guarantee. Higher rate is USD $10,000 per day pro rata. Commission is again, address commission is 2.5% from the charterer and 1.25% from the broker's behalf. Redelivery. Now, since we are studying the time charter, it needs to be delivered and redelivered. Dropping last outward sea pilot. One safe port in Indian Ocean region. All the other terms and conditions should be discussed as per the charter party dated this. And finally, it is put on the subjects. Now, I know, guys, that all these abbreviations which I'm using, it's quite difficult to understand. So I would put the information, the site where you can get all these information from. So you can always refer to the website down and you can check it by yourself. It's because of time, because of time constraint, I'm not able to explain you each and every concept here. But I would like you guys to, you know, have a look. If you're really interested, just type this thing on Google and you will know a lot about it. So let's go ahead. The negotiation stage. The actual negotiation stage, as we said, is divided into two parts, where we saw like the prefixtures, where the main terms were discussed. And finally, once that is done, it is put to the subject to details. So what is subjects? Subjects is means like, you know, subject to a certain condition. Once the vessel has, you know, completed the negotiation phase, it needs to be checked. So what that means is it needs to be checked, or it should be accepted. So we do have something called as subject to vessel's acceptance at load port, or there is something also called as, you know, vessel subjected to acceptance at discharge port, subjected to supplier's confirmation that cargo is available or not, subject to charter's management approval. You know, one of the instances I would like to share with you is when I was in one of the ships where I was in Singapore, and we were supposed to go towards Japan, Osaka. We just finished our loading in Singapore and we're just about to head for this Osaka. But we got reply from the charterers that please don't proceed towards the destined port because the discharge port didn't have the right mooring or berthing arrangement for our ship. These all things are supposed to be checked by the charterers in a specific time frame. Okay, this time frame can be around 24 hours, it can be 2 days, 48 hours. Okay, but the thing is, when the vessel is being put on subjects, the owner of the vessel can't negotiate his vessel with any other charterer. So in which the vessel gets locked for the time frame. Okay, that's the best standard practice which we follow in the chartering. Subject to receivers approval, subject to charterer's board of directors to be lifted, subject to owner's board of directors, because the people who are doing negotiations are chartering officers. These are the ones who are responsible persons under the principals who deal with them. So they need to get it approved from their principals too, right? Subjected to owner's full approval to the pro forma charter party dated with logical amendments thereto. There is no fixture until all the subjects are lifted. Once the subjects are lifted, that means everything is checked, the vessel will go for the voyage. Negotiating, as we discussed, when we negotiate, we use these phrases as we saw in last slides. And once the charter party has been negotiated, there is a clean recap. A recap is it's drawn by the broker. It's proof of what the terms and conditions have been agreed between the ship owner and the charter. It can be in a form of email, it can be a form of fax, it can be in a form of telex, it depends. So finally, to conclude the whole lecture to the whole chartering process, we saw the first thing is charter puts up an inquiry. He goes to the broker and he gives it. The offer is being provided by the ship owner to the charter. Then the negotiation and counter negotiation starts. Once that is done, the vessel is put on subjects. After that, negotiation of the charter party terms. We'll look into the charter party as in our upcoming lectures. We'll look each and everything in depth too. Once that is done, the subjects are lifted. And if the subjects are lifted, we draw a clean recap. Once the clean recap is drawn, we draw up a charter party, which is sent to the respective principals, get it signed, and we execute the whole voyage. Question of the day. I would like you guys to refer one of the shipping presses such as Fairplays, Lloyd List. Pull out some orders, fixtures, or position. Try to decipher it by yourself. And let me know in the comment section below how you do it.
And hit the like button, guys, if you like the video. And always remember, one of the most important tips and feedback come from you guys. So feel free to connect me on LinkedIn and pop up a message. And thanks for checking out the video, guys. Subscribe if you haven't already. In the next lecture, we'll be looking into some additional terms used in chartering. Until next time, ShipScope is bringing you the best platform to learn about the commercial shipping subject. So keep on learning it, and we will talk soon.